as we sing our opening. I'm so glad we're a part of the family of God. We drink God's fountain and feast on God's love. Walking with Jesus as we travel along. We're a part of the family, the family.
Wow, what a beautiful morning. What a good-looking crowd this morning on this beautiful Sunday morning. Would you take just a minute very quickly to reach around those who were closest to you and hug their necks and shake their hands and let them know how delighted you are to see them. Let's sing it again. Here we go.
I'm so glad we're a part of the family of God. We drink from God's fountain and feast on God's love. Walking with Jesus as we travel.
Sound wonderful. You can be seated if you'd like. Welcome to Bluegrass United Church of Christ. We look forward to this. You know, I tell folks often, I think probably one of the big differences in our church and our congregation and a lot of other churches that I've been to or been around, we look forward to getting together on Sunday morning. We don't come out of a sense of obligation. We don't come out of a sense of guilt. We come because we enjoy being here. We enjoy fellowshipping with our family and our brothers and sisters, and we enjoy coming and learning about the things of God. So thank you for being here this morning. Pastor Marcia is on week number 2 of her sabbatical, and we miss her. We miss her more. I told her, she and I were communicating this morning, and I told her, I said, we really, really miss you all the time, but we especially miss you on Sunday mornings. But she sends her love, and of course she sends her prayers, and we send those to she and Brenda. They're out and about traveling now. We have some announcements, some things that are coming up. It's always exciting around BUCC. Want to remind the elders that we'll be meeting this Tuesday at 6 o'clock here at the church. The church council will be meeting this Tuesday at 7 o'clock. So if you're on either one of those boards or committees, then be sure to take note of that. The BUCC Seenagers, probably one of the most exciting groups in our church right now. They go out and party all night on Saturday nights and show up ready to do church on Sunday morning. I don't see how they do it.
You're
right. Miss Elnora's really been pushing me. She says, Kenny, you're 50 now. You belong in the Seenagers. I hear it's fun, and I hear you all are just living life to its fullest. The Seenagers are going to be meeting this Saturday here at the church. They'll be gathering, and they're going to have a meal. They're going to have lunch. If you'd like to come and join them, is there, Dean, if somebody, let's say, 30, 35 shows up, Can they stay? As long as they bring a side dish. So bring a side dish. The teenagers are going to provide the meat. We don't know what that is yet. It may be spam, but... This Saturday, come and join the teenagers here at noon at the church. It's going to be a lot of fun. You know, probably one of the bigger, if not the largest outreach that our church does every year is at the Lexington Pride Festival. And we take a lot of pride in that because it's an incredible, incredible outreach. And we would love for you to be a part of that and be a part of that impact. Anna Gail, is it okay? Daniel, may I borrow your microphone for just a minute? I want to get to Anna Gail so she can kind of give us some details on what we're doing.
The sign-up sheet has filled up. We're doing very well on that. Brandy Hosmer has volunteered to do face painting, so we're adding that this year. Dean, when are we going to have a teaching session for making peace cranes? Not to put you on the spot. But... Okay, so you'll hear more about that. We still need people to sign up. There's still spots on the booths. I think the folding people are, we've got that filled up, but we could still use more.
What are you talking about?
The peace cranes.
What peace cranes?
Well, that's the interactive project. If you'd listen to me when I talk to you, yes, Lord. Our interactive activity this year is Elaine Foy brought this to Dean and myself. We were talking about what we could do and involve more people. We did peace flags last year, and it was very successful. Dean just brings these wonderful ideas. And Elaine had us a story, the book's out there. If you would look at the display that Dean put up 2 weeks ago in the Fellowship Hall, you would be more informed. But it's wonderful. It's a Japanese story, a legend, where 1,000 peace cranes will bring peace to the community or healing or different ways to look at it. But we're going to have people who teach people. It's an origami thing, folding paper. We'll assist somebody. They'll take theirs with them. We're going to keep ours, display them at our Pride booth, suspend them from the ceiling in here somehow. They're beautiful. So that's what the peace cranes are here.
What are some about the 4th of July parade?
Oh, yeah, we're going to walk with them on sticks. Very good. You did listen to that. Name, maybe forget what I'm saying. Oh, tattoos. We need people who can put on tattoos. They're real easy to do, but we need tattooers. So let me know about that as well. But we need lots of people there. So if you don't sign up but you're at Pride, stop by our booth and we'll put you to work.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anna Gail. And you all can catch the Anna Gail and Harris show every Tuesday night at the Ramada out on Paris Pike. Did you mention Vacation Bible School?
Vacation Bible School is July 24th through 28th. Len Stocker is directing them. I don't have
no, go ahead.
Vacation Bible School, July 24th through 28th. Len Stocker is organizing that. We will have more information once we survive Pride about that. But we can use lots of people and lots of kids. So see me if you have any questions.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Thank you, Anna Gail. Rita.
Next week, I'll be selling the Fair Trade coffee and other products. Next week is Father's Day, so maybe you'd like to buy a pound of coffee for some of the fathers in your lives. We'll have many different kinds of coffee and a dwindling supply of chocolate.
Wow, I love that chocolate and I love that coffee. Thank you, Rita. Let's do this. Let's just take a deep, deep breath and center into what God wants to say to us today. Let's sing that chorus again. I love my family. Let's sing.
I'm so glad we're a part of the family of God. And we drink from God's fountain and feast on God's love. Walking with Jesus as we travel along. We're a part.
Please join me in our call to worship. God's love is real in our lives.
God, help us to recognize your love.
It is God's love that sustains us and gives us peace.
God, help us to be grateful for your love.
We have been given love so that we can give love.
God, help us be generous with your love.
Please join me in prayer. Dear God, this week many of us watched the eulogy of Muhammad Ali. He had requested that the service be multicultural, multireligious, multiracial. One after another came to the podium to speak. First, an Islamic cleric and a Baptist preacher, an Orthodox rabbi, a Mormon senator, and some professing no faith. They spoke eloquently of the goodness, generosity, and love of the man from Louisville. Prior to the funeral, during the procession, many tens of thousands flocked around the motorcade, touching the car, waving their arms, tears running down their faces, shouting, "Ali, Ali, Ali." He was truly loved because his own love for God and his love for others had no bounds. Dear God, we want to love like that. Following the tragic Amish school shooting of 10 young schoolgirls in a one-room Amish school in October 2006, extraordinary love was exhibited by the families of those children. In the midst of their grief over the shocking loss, the Amish reached out with grace and compassion towards the killer's family. The afternoon of the shooting, an Amish grandfather of one of the girls expressed forgiveness towards the killer, Charles Roberts. That same day, Amish neighbors visited the killer's family to comfort them in their sorrow and pain. Later that week, the Robbins family was invited to the funeral of one of the Amish girls who had been killed. They not only spoke words of forgiveness to them, but they also loved and comforted the parents of their children's killer. Dear God, we want to love like that. Almost a year ago, on June 17, in Charleston, South Carolina, a young man named Dylan Roof was welcomed to the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church. He sat and listened for nearly an hour as a group of 12 studied a passage from the Gospel of Mark. Then he stood and opened fire with a gun he'd received as a present for his 21st birthday. It was a cold-blooded attack by an avowed white supremacist intending to provoke a race war in the heart of the old Confederacy. 9 were murdered, 5 survived. Not many days later, families of some of those dear good people stood in court and told the young man who had ripped out their hearts, "I forgive you." Dear God, we want to love like that. This morning, members of our own family have been attacked, 20 killed and 42 wounded. Love is not the emotion we are feeling, but we know that your love is so much more than an emotion. Give us hearts and minds that go beyond our feelings. Guide us in how we can love in this situation. Help us to have, to learn, to teach, to be examples of love. Amen.
Amen. Rise as we sing our first hymn.
Shared and misery relieved, where truth is spoken, children spared, equality achieved. We welcome one world family and struggle with each choice. Thee opened us to unity and gives our vision voice. The poor are rich, the weak are strong.
strong. The foolish ones are wise. Tell all who mourn, outcasts belong, who perishes will rise. Oh, for a world preparing for God's glorious reign of peace, where time and tears will be no more, and all but love will cease.
Be seated.
Now's the time that we share our joys and concerns, a time we feel safe and know our family here will celebrate with us, will mourn with us, and will support us. And I'll start out with a few things that I know this morning. I noticed on Facebook it's Children's Day, and so let's celebrate all of our precious little ones and all the children of the world. We also give thanks today that Peggy Agelhart's blood work was such that she could receive her chemo on Monday. And Michael Previtt's blood work was good enough that he got to go home. He was at UK Samaritan this week. And we're glad that Ron's with us today, home from VA. So we're glad to have you back. So we have lots to celebrate. And of course, our hearts are saddened by the news of the death of the 13-day-old baby that Daniel shared with us. And of course, our hearts are broken at the news this morning of yet another mass shooting in Orlando. We'll pray this morning for all involved. Are there others that we need to share this morning?
I have a friend that's waiting on results to see if she's got thyroid cancer, so.
Okay. What's her first name?
Morgan.
Okay.
Cindy, my uncle George has lung cancer, and they've stopped treatment, and it's probably just a matter of days, would you say, or any time. So him and his family.
Okay.
My dad's brother.
Okay. We'll keep them in mind. Stephen?
Yep. Keep me in your prayer. Don't go through this crazy tough time right now.
We certainly will. Ron.
First, we'll thank your family, please. My cousin was at the club last night.
Oh.
I spoke with him shortly at midnight. And I got her pregnant since.
Oh, so sorry. What's his name, first name?
Robert.
Okay. Others? Stanley?
I want to be thankful for everything that God does for me, for the nature outside we can enjoy, and pray for all these that have been brought up, pray for the world, pray for Marcia and Brendan as they're away from us, be with Avall, Hope Positive, and
people I
work with at Kroger and my family.
Okay, sure will. Brandy?
I have a young man. I'm helping take care of him with my part-time job doing the CNA. His mother is having a difficult time dealing with it. He's been disabled for his whole life, but she's having a difficult time dealing with his disability and just the emotional stuff that comes with it. So we can pray for her.
Certainly.
And comfort she needs.
Certainly we will. Are there others?
Yes, one more thing. We just remember my little brother David is having, Baby Jay is having surgery on Tuesday. He has a deviated septum with bone spurs and they're going to go in, but he wouldn't have the surgery if they use narcotics. He told them he was allergic to narcotics. He likes them. So just prayers for his strength, you know.
That'll be tough.
He's painful and he's going to be on the ibuprofen.
We certainly will keep David in our prayers. Yes.
I'm really grateful that my cousin's here, my cousin Drew, and I also need prayers for my sister. She had bunion surgery, and It was a really painful, like, foot surgery, and she was having a tough time with it. She's also, like, having some of her PTSD set back in, so just, you know, she prays for her that she can get on the plane next year.
And what's her name?
Laura. Yeah,
Laura. Okay. We'll keep her. Yes, Harris.
But especially with this latest tragedy, I want the feeling inside me that there's something I can do to stop hate.
Amen.
And I think there's others that feel that way.
Carolyn, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yes, I just want to still ask for all the prayers for my healing. I'm still having quite a few meltdowns. And I just feel like I'm getting aggravated with God. And I know that's not good.
Yeah.
It's not good, but y'all just keep praying that I will get stronger.
And God understands.
Oh, yes. Yes, I know. Yes.
Certainly. Anyone else? Okay. Yes.
I want to add prayers for Keith, and who recently has taken leave of absence from us. And I hope he finds what he needs.
As do we. Yeah. Anyone else? Okay, let's sing.
To us on a winter night in baby's breath by firelight, God comes to us on a star. God comes to us amidst our fears, unspoken joy, unending tears. God comes to us where we are.
Holy God, we are gathered here this morning to give praise to you. We are thankful for our blessings, and we send up prayers for those who don't share in all of our many blessings. For the hungry, we ask nourishment. For the stressed, we ask relief. For the violence, we ask your peace. For the lonely, we ask companionship. For the homeless, we ask for safe shelter. For the heartbroken, we ask for love and caring. For the ill, we ask for your healing touch. And for the dying, we ask for your presence. And then we ask ourselves, how can we be your hands and feet to make these things happen? Teach us how to be your extension on earth. Teach us how to prevent Orlando. How your and our hearts ache this morning in yet one more senseless killing spree. We ask you to be with Orlando, with those exposed directly to this violence, the injured and the dead and their families. There are no words we can say, but we know your presence will make a difference. For every soul here today hurting, we ask that they will feel your love and caring touch, that they will know they are loved fully by you and by this church family. Bring us together and be with Kenny and the worship team as they continue to lead us this morning. These things we ask in your name. Amen. Amen.
God comes to us on a winter night in baby's breath by firelight. God comes to us on a star. God comes to us amidst our fears, unspoken joy, unending tears. God comes to us where we are.
Will the children join me, please? Good morning, guys. We're going to talk about love today. We talk about it a lot, don't we? I'm going to tell you about something I love. I love lots of stuff. I love lots of people. But I'm going to tell you today about my cat. I have a cat who's gray. He has a crooked tail. And his name is Boo because I got him at Halloween. I love Boo because he will run to me when I come in the house, and if I go, he'll come up to me and he'll put this, y'all are going to think this is gross, but he'll put his mouth right here, put his nose right there, and then he'll put his head under my chin and he'll stay there as long as I sit still, and I sleep on my side and he'll sleep right here. He climbs up on me and sleeps with me. And all he wants me to do is pet him and feed him and talk to him. Do you have anything you love? What do you love, Bryn? It could be anything. What do you love?
I love my kitty cat.
You love your kitty cat? What do you love? Do you love trains? Cool. How do you feel when you think about your kitty cat or your trains? Do you feel good inside? You feel kind of warm? And it's a feeling that's really hard to explain, isn't it? Well, the scripture we're going to read from the Bible today tells us that that feeling is God. Because it says several places, but also in the scripture that we're going to read today, it says God is love. That's hard to understand, I think. But if I think about the way I feel when I think about my family or my church or my job or my cat Boo, it feels really good and warm inside. So if I think of that being what God is, then it's easier to understand who God is, isn't it? So think about that when you're thinking about trains and when you're thinking about your cat. Your kitty cat. You have three? All three of them. That's a lot of love. That's God. Can we pray together? Dear God, thank you for giving us the gift of love.
Thank you for giving us the gift of love.
So that we have a way to know,
who you are.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, guys.
Today's scripture reading is from 1 John 4, 7 through 12, and 16 through 21. Dear friends, let's love each other because love is from God, and everyone who loves is born from God and knows God. The person who doesn't love does not know God because God is love. This is how the love of God is revealed to us. God has sent his only Son into the world that we can live through him. This is love. It is not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice that deals with our sins. Dear friends, if God loved us this way, we also ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God. If we love each other, God remains in us, and his love is made perfect in us. We have known and have believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And those who remain in love remain in God, and God remains in them. This is how love has been perfected in us, so that we can have confidence on the judgment day, because we are exactly the same as God is in this world. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear expects punishment. The person who is afraid has not been made perfect in love. We love because God first loved us. If anyone says, "I love God," and hates a brother or sister, he's a liar. Because the person who doesn't love a brother or sister who can be seen can't love God, who can't be seen. This commandment we have from him: those who claim to love God ought to love their brother and sister also. This is the word of God to us.
Thanks be to God. I've known for a few weeks now that this would be my Sunday to preach at BUCC. This is, after the years that I've been here, this is the first time I've actually been behind the pulpit to share a message and to share a sermon. Some of you saw on Facebook earlier this week that I think I scared some of you. Especially Anna Gail. Especially when you found out and learned that Daniel would be stepping in as the worship leader this morning, a Pentecostal preacher and a Pentecostal worship leader can do some damage. So we know that Marcia is praying really hard wherever she is right now. But knowing that I was going to be here this morning, but not knowing the tragedy of last night, I'm grateful that I stopped, paused, and asked God what we should discuss today, what we should talk about. Especially when I heard Carol say that perfect love casts out all fear. We just got word while Carol was praying earlier that the death toll has risen in Orlando. The latest number now is 50. There are 50 hearts and families that right now are as angry at God as they've ever been. They question and they wonder why God would allow something like that to happen to them, to someone they love. And rest assured, many of us know that not every person in that club had a family who understood their life and understood who they were. And so there are some families right now who are really grieving a loss, because they are as convinced as they've ever been that that is a life not from God. So we're going to pray that God speaks to their hearts and gives them comfort and gives them courage and gives them peace. I talked with Marcia this morning, as I mentioned. I said, "Marcia, this is a heavy morning for me to stand behind that pulpit." And she said, "Kenny, remind our flock of this, that in the midst of anything, individually, communally, or globally, God is present with us, always present with us." So we trust God to do something good in that place. And like Harris mentioned earlier, it's hard for us not to be angry. Cindy mentioned this too. It's hard for us not to be angry right now. We want to be very angry right now because someone has done a terrible, terrible thing. And you may know someone there. I have lots of friends in Orlando that I'm very concerned about, and there are family members there that we're very concerned about. So we pray. And I thank God that we're able to share this scripture and this message this morning. I've got to tell you, I wrestled with whether or not to wear a tie today. There's not a big old robe back there that fits me. So I
tried to go back and forth with the tie, and I decided against it. Several years ago, I was actually a part of a revival service over in Eastern Kentucky, a series of services over there, and it was a Sunday night when I was scheduled to speak, and I realized about two-thirds of the way there that I had forgotten my tie. Now, this was an old Pentecostal church where you have to wear a tie and long sleeves. And so as soon as I got to the church, I went to where the pastor was in the study, and I said, "Do you happen to have a tie that I can borrow?" And he started to take his watch off. And he said, "My friend, my people don't care whether you have a tie or not, but you cannot get in the pulpit without a watch." So, I'm wearing my watch. Imagine if Carol had read the scripture, and everywhere you find the word love, you replaced it with the word hate. Imagine if the scripture that we hold so dear said, "Dear friends, let's hate each other, because hate is from God, and everyone who hates is born from God. The person who doesn't hate does not know God, because God is hate." Imagine if that was the scripture we follow, the scripture we treasure. Thankfully, God has a favorite four-letter word: love. Let us love one another. A couple of years ago, I was traveling. I was on my way to Minneapolis for some work I was doing there. Now, I'd like to tell you that I'm one of those people, especially one of those preachers who prays before he gets on a plane and says, "God, give me an opportunity to witness your love." Truth is, I'm the guy that's praying, "God, please give me a whole row to myself." I want to tell you, I am not nearly as super spiritual as I would like to be most of the time. Sometimes I'll actually get to the airport and I'm sitting in the gate area waiting for the flight to be called, and I start looking around and thinking, "Oh, I hope I don't sit next to that one or that one. I hope that one's on a different flight." All of those things. I'm a horrible Christian sometimes. I'm really a horrible Christian sometimes. On this particular trip, I had some work I needed to get done. And the announcement was made, and everybody got in line, and is often the case, it was every person for themselves. I fell in, scanned my boarding pass, walked on the jetway, and boarded the plane, and immediately started looking for my seat, my row. Started looking ahead to see if anybody, number one, you don't want anybody in your seat. It's so awkward to ask somebody to get out of your seat. But I started scanning for my row, and praise be to Jesus, it was empty. I was one of the later people to get on the plane. I usually will wait until late to get on the plane for a couple of reasons. Number one, especially if it's going to be a long flight, I try not to sit there any longer than I have to on the plane. But number two, with some of the airlines, once that overhead space gets filled, then they'll check your bag for free and you save some dollars. I'm a horrible Christian. I got on the plane and I found my row, and sure enough, the whole row was empty, and I'm thinking, "Oh, thank God, I'm going to have some peace. I've got some work that I can get done, and I'll have the whole row to myself." So I went and I settled in. I put my bag, my laptop bag, in front of me in the seat underneath, and I sat there for a while thinking, "Wow, it's going to be a sweet flight to Minneapolis." And I happened to glance up and I saw this really tall guy in a really nice suit making his way through the plane. And I thought, he's dressed way too nice to be sitting back here with us. But he kept walking. And like everybody else, like me and everybody else on the plane, he started scanning the rows to see where he was supposed to go. And as he got closer, I was like, a little anxiety taking hold. And sure enough, he gets to my row. And he throws his bag underneath the seat in front of him, and he sits down. And there's one space between me and him, and I'm thinking, I can handle this. I got most or part of a row to myself. And I was ready to settle in, thinking the flight would be good. We said hello. He went back to his business. I went back to mine, of being a horrible Christian. It's just about pushback time from the gate when this young lady, who looked more like a little girl, got on the plane. She looked very disheveled. She looked very unput together, and she looked like it took her last breath to get to that plane in time before they closed the door. She stepped in, the door was closed, and she was coughing, and she was sniffling, and her hair was disheveled, and I thought, dear God, no. There are other empty seats on the plane, and if you love me, one of them belongs to her. But she kept coming. And she kept coughing, and she kept sniffling, and she finally found her row, her way to my row. She stepped past the gentleman on the end and literally fell into the seat next to me. Fell into the seat next to me and was... I'm looking out the window. I'm looking down. I'm playing with my phone in airplane mode where you can't do anything. Anything to distract myself. I'm looking at the in-flight magazine that I'd already seen 3 times that month, but anything to keep from looking at her and facing her. And she fell down into the seat, and she looks over, and I look at her, and then I look back out the window. I don't want to have a conversation. I want to get some work done, and I want to get some rest. She probably sensed my attitude. But I'm thinking, she didn't want to get that sort of vibe and that sort of judgment from people. She should take better care of herself. I'm a horrible Christian. You shouldn't walk around in daylight looking like nighttime. About the time she fell into her seat, the flight attendant strolled past, and she gave the young lady a special look. I don't know, maybe flight attendants are trained to look for people like that. Jeff used to be a flight attendant. She even asked the girl if she was in the right seat. She didn't ask anybody else on the plane, but she asked the girl if she was in the right seat, and I was kind of secretly hoping she wasn't. But she showed her boarding pass, and sure enough, she was exactly where she was supposed to be. So it looked like we were going to have to settle in for the next couple of hours. The plane started moving, and I tried to keep myself pretend distracted with the in-flight magazine and my phone and everything else. And then from out of nowhere, I heard this little voice all stopped up say, "Do you have a tissue?" "Pardon me? I was just wondering if you might have a tissue." "I'm sorry, I don't." I was kind of hoping that would be the extent of our conversation. "That's okay. Thanks anyway." She continued to sniff and cough. About every minute or so, she'd try to rest her head in her lap, and then she'd sit up, and then she'd try to rest it again. And I noticed from time to time she would shiver. She had a shiver, and I tried to ignore it, because sometimes I'm a horrible Christian. I sat there looking out the window, sort of off in my own world, when I felt it. It was a tickle on my neck. Her head had fallen over and rested on my shoulder. And apparently, she was good at it because I didn't even feel it land. But I felt the tickle on my neck. I kind of thought I should be angry about it, or at least uncomfortable enough to kind of, you know, move her up and move her out of the way, but I wasn't, and I didn't. I probably would have until I felt the heat from her face. And I watched her shiver. She laid her head there for just a few seconds, and then she raised her head very quickly, and she apologized. And then she asked the guy on the other side if he had a tissue. He very curtly said no, and then she just kind of looked back at me and rolled her eyes and did that sort of thing. And she kind of had a little bit of a grin on her face. But that's when I saw her eyes. Those very heavy, sad eyes. Her eyeliner was smudged, and it looked like it had some point had run down her face. Her hair was disheveled and all messed up. She really looked like she had had a really rough night. She coughed and she sniffed, and she asked me what was bringing me to Minneapolis, and I told her that I was coming into town for business, and she lit up and she said, "Oh, yay! You should come see my show. My name's Destiny." "Hi, Destiny. My name's Kenny. It's good to meet you. You just let me know if you want to come see the show. I'll make sure you get a great seat. Give me your number." I said, "You're really, really kind to offer, but I'm not sure I'm going to have enough time to get out and see a show." "Well, give me your number just in case." She was pretty persistent. What kind of grown man in his 40s at the time gives his phone number to a fragile young lady on a plane? Whatever kind of man that is, apparently I'm one of them. She said, "I'll call you." Trying to steer the conversation off to a different place, I asked her if Minneapolis was home to her, and if so, where she had been, and she said she'd been to Atlanta. I said, "Really? Cool. I like Atlanta." She said, "I've been there for treatment. They're trying to get rid of this cancer." I didn't know if it was a metaphor or if she really was battling cancer. "You've been getting treatment for cancer?" "Yeah, they do it for charity there," she said. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen could ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bow down with care. God sent the Son to win, and every child is reconciled and pardoned from their sin. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall coming from cancer treatment. You're sick. You're freezing and you're burning up and you're coughing. Why in the world are you traveling? This man I live with in Minneapolis told me that I've got to get back home. Is he your dad? No. He owns the club where I work. He's meeting me at the airport and he's taking me home. I didn't know what to say. I didn't know if I should offer some words, some advice, something. So I turned and stared out the window. Sometimes I'm a horrible Christian. And then her head landed on my shoulder again. The sense of dread and disgust disgust that I'd felt earlier turned to sadness and hurt. She shivered and she curled up as best she could to try to stay warm. So I pulled my jacket out of my bag and I covered her up. And she still shivered. After only a minute, she signaled for the flight attendant and asked for her second cup of water. She almost inhaled the first one. It was taking a while for the flight attendant to bring the water, so she asked me if she could have the rest of mine, and I gave it to her. She didn't offer any thanks, but she took me up on it, took it off my tray, and drank it as fast as she could, and then she used the napkin to wipe her nose. As Destiny continued to shiver, cough, and snivel her way through the flight, alternating between my shoulder and her own lap, I sat there, wondering where the people were who were supposed to love her. Who would let her walk out of a hospital? And who would summon her back to that sort of work in a condition like that? Be honest with you, I was also wondering what kind of germs were on my jacket now and my shoulder. An announcement about rough air mid-flight startled her awake, and she fell back into our conversation right where she left off, like she hadn't even fallen asleep. She wasn't sure where her mom was. She never mentioned her dad. She had a brother, but they didn't get along. The man in Minneapolis, he fed her and gave her a place to sleep and a job. Soon the announcement that we were nearing the airport was made, and Destiny reluctantly sat up and inadvertently wiped her nose on the sleeve of my jacket and then offered it back to me. I told her she could keep it. The plane landed and we pulled to the gate, and everyone unclicked their seat belts. And as the rows emptied, Destiny was anxious and nervous, and she would stand and she would sit and she would stand again. And finally she stepped out into the aisleway before it was her turn, and she looked down at me and invited me to come see her perform one more time. I hope you have time to come see the show. I think you'll like it. I thanked her again for the offer and asked her if she knew for sure that her ride was going to be there to pick her up, and I wished her well. She turned to walk away, and she looked back and she said, "You're a good guy. I'll call you." I sat there, and I watched her disappear into the crowd and out the door with my jacket. I didn't want it back, but I wanted her back. My heart was broken, and I wondered, what is my responsibility to God's love? I'm supposed to show and reveal love. And how will people recognize God's love? And how will people recognize God? Sometimes you have to be literally on the brink of exhaustion and desperation before you realize God's love. And sometimes you have to find yourself in the middle of someone else's exhaustion and desperation before you realize God's love, and before you realize that you are to be the destiny, the destination, the vessel for God's love. These words were found penciled on the walls of an insane asylum after a patient there had passed on. Frederick Lehman, a great songwriter, discovered the words one day and he added them to his beautiful hymn, "The Love of God." But imagine someone who is locked in a room with no hope of ever finding an outside or a normal life. Someone who would literally live their last breath in that room, penning words such as these on the wall for others to find long after they were gone, that testify to the love of God. Could we with ink the ocean fill, and were the skies of parchment made, were every stalk on earth a quill, and every man a scribe by trade. Hear this. To write the love of God above would drain the ocean dry, nor could the scroll contain the whole, though stretched from sky to sky. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. It shall So whose responsibility is it? It's the responsibility of the Bluegrass United Church of Christ. Amen. It's the responsibility of all of us who get up on Sunday morning and we get ourselves together as best we can and we come through these doors and we fellowship with one another and we truly want to know the burden or the heartache or the struggle or the joy that we share since we met last week. That's the reason Cindy stands and says, tell me what we can delight in today. Tell me what we can pray about today. Tell me the joys that we can rejoice with you with and the burdens that we can help you carry. It's our responsibility. That's the reason the scripture says that God is love. And if God is to be reflected anywhere in this world, it'll be in and through the people of Bluegrass United Church of Christ. Not just here, but certainly here. There are many of us all around the world who carry that responsibility. It's not a guilty responsibility, but it's a joy and it's a delight to be able to stand and say, I know your burdens are heavy sometimes, and I know that your road gets long sometimes, but there is the love of God. And it is the love of God that gives us our strength and gives us our joy. That's the reason we grin from ear to ear sometimes. Just in the middle of the day, maybe even sometimes in the middle of your struggle. And I know I've heard from some of you this week that you faced it, but still you found the love of God in the middle of all of that. So I'll ask you, what is our responsibility to God's love? How does God show and reveal love? And how will people recognize God's love? How will people recognize God? It's because we walked it, talked it, and believed it all along the way. God, help us be the example of your love, because we know that your love does not discriminate in any way, in any form, in any fashion. And your love is for everyone. Amen. And that brings us here, where we as a church get to live it out and offer a plate to everyone, absolutely everyone. I've often thought, wouldn't it just be really, really cool sometime if our diaconates were serving communion through the church and we work our way back through the congregation and then we get to the door and we keep going? And we knock on doors and somebody opens the door and we stick a plate in front of them.
Because that's really how we feel, isn't it? There's not a person in this community, there's no one in a house anywhere around us that can't eat from this table. Everyone gets to eat from this table. It doesn't matter what they did last night. They still get to eat from this table. I don't want to ask you what you did last night. But we still get to eat from this table. Thank God this table belongs to everyone. Let's prepare to eat.
For everyone born, a place at the table. For everyone born, clean water and bread. A shelter, a space, a safe place for growing. For everyone born, a star overhead. And God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy, compassion and peace. Yes, God will delight when we are creators of justice and joy.
I like this.
For everyone born, a place at the table, to live without fear and simply to be, to work, to speak out, to witness and worship. For everyone born, God will delight when we are creators of justice, justice and joy.
Our diaconates want to join me. God, thank you. We have a lot to be afraid of today. The news overnight terrified us. We realized that probably all of us are not far from being a victim of some kind, some sort. There's a lot to be afraid of. But God, we are so grateful to be reminded from the Scripture today that You are love, and perfect love casts out all fear. So thank You for Your love. Thank You for the example that Jesus Christ gave us in how to live and how to serve and how to love and how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
It was about to be a long night. The disciples probably weren't entirely aware of what was going on, but it was going to be a long night. As they sat around the table and they ate and they had conversation, and if they're like us, and we've all been around the dinner table and we've all had conversation, and there may have been somebody down on this end talking about somebody down on that end. You've heard the rumors. You know what he did. You know what he said. James thinks he's better than the rest of us. Thomas, I doubt it. But they were like us. Sometimes they got along and sometimes they didn't. But that was no good reason for them not to be at the table. So they were there.
And Jesus spoke to them and said, basically, this is going to be a really significant night in all of your lives. Let's remember it. One of the most special and sacred things that we can do is eat together, share a meal together. And that night, with Jesus and the disciples at the table, Jesus broke the bread. And he gave it to his disciples. And he said, you know how special this is. You know how significant this is. Take the bread and eat. Get yourself full of it. So he blessed it. And he distributed it. And everyone there got to eat. I don't know who else was in the room. Apparently there was a photographer there. The room may have been full of people. Everybody got to eat. I'm convinced that Jesus wouldn't just say, if you're at this table, you qualify. Everybody gets to eat. As Pastor Marcia has said so many times, we can't find any rules that exclude anybody. Everything we read and see says, come, come and eat and enjoy. So he took the cup and he blessed it. And he gave it to his disciples and he said, just as surely as you've gotten your fill with the bread, take the cup, take the wine and enjoy. And share. Share it with everyone you come in contact with. Extend the invitation. Open the door. Make the appeal loud and strong. But eat, drink, and enjoy. As the elements come past you, take a piece of bread. Take a cup. Pause, reflect for a moment. Thank God for this opportunity. And let's be in communion with God. Amen. Every Sunday, about 2 minutes before the service starts, you'll notice on the screen a list of people who are serving this week. And we do that very intentionally because we're a family and we're a community. Somebody has to bring the sides. We'll do the meat every chance we get, but somebody's got to bring the sides. And so you see this list of people, and these are people who've cut grass and worked in the parking lot and worked in the building, and they worked during the service and before the service. And it's very intentional that we put that there because we want everyone to be aware of the people who contribute. And that's not even the exhaustive list. That's the most recent list. And so we're grateful for everything that everyone gives. And everyone is so generous and beautiful about your giving and your loving about your giving. And I especially want to say thank you to Daniel for stepping in this morning as worship leader, doing an incredible job, always does. And all of you, we want to thank you in the many, many, many ways that you give to support what we do here, to be able to be that example and that extension of God's love. It takes you. So thank you. God, take these offerings that we're about to receive, bless them, use them to accomplish the thing that you set them out to do. We pray and believe in your name. Amen. Would you stand?
God blesses us so we can give. With one another we should live. God blesses us with each new
grateful. I look back and I can't help but think that God had a hand in what needed to be said today, what needed to happen here today. It was before the tragic events of last night. I have a good idea because I know there are people in this room who live with it. Sometimes I have to live with it. There were people in that place last night who have been told that God does not love them. And they were told enough that they believed it. They were convinced of it. It angers me. It breaks my heart. It disturbs me. Last week, Brenda and Daniel and I started talking about this closing hymn, and I said, you know, I feel like I just want to do something different. I want to affirm the message with that closing hymn. Billy, go ahead. And some of you are familiar with this. If you're not, just hum along. You'll catch it. You'll find it. I want us all to remember this.
I am loved. I am loved. I can risk loving you. For the world
We are free to love each other. We are love. Can we sing that again? You're not going to stay here as long as a Pentecostal service would go. And I don't want to belabor the point, but what I do want to encourage you to do today is to be that love. There are a lot of people today who really need that love. There are a lot of scared people today. I woke up and saw the news and I was frightened. There are a lot of scared people. They need to be reminded of that love, God's love. And you may be the vessel, maybe the only vessel that gets to show that to them. So I want to encourage you to do that. And I want to encourage you, if you're here this morning and you want to be a part of this family, I would love to meet you here and hug your neck and shake your hand and invite you in. We're a motley crew sometimes. Like Marcia says, sometimes we're a mess. But we'd love for you to come and be a part of this mess. Let's sing the second verse of that. Each other. We are free to love each other. We are love. Now go and be blessed and show that love. Amen.
Amen.
We are walking in the light of God. 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 We are walking, we are walking, we are walking in the light of God. We are walking, we are walking. We are walking in the light of God. We are singing 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 in the light of God. We are singing, we are singing. We are singing in the light of God. We are singing, we are singing, we are singing in the light of God. We are dancing 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 in the light of God. We are dancing, we are dancing, we are dancing in the light of God.